We have 5 data points and we fitted a line by linear regression. The slope of the line is 2.2 and the intercept is 1. We also calculated the R squared and that is equal to 0.8462. So we concluded that our linear model has quite a good fit for the data. But our task of fitting a linear model to data does not end here. One can ask how confident you are about this model. Is this linear equation a good estimate of the real linear relation between x and y in the population? Okay, that's quite a mouthful. So let me elaborate. We go back to the key assumption of statistical analysis. We assume that there is a population and from that population we are doing some random sampling. So when we do some experiment and make some measurements, we are actually generating a sample. We repeat the sampling a few times. From the sampled measurement, we want to estimate the measurements for the population. Note that you will never be able to investigate the whole population. Now we have a problem. Rather than having the real value for a measurement in the population, we have an estimate for that. Now how do I know that that estimate is reasonable? To answer this type of questions, we use statistical tests. Now get back to the problem of regression. We had 5 data points and we fitted the data to the equation y hat equal to bx plus a. We have got the numerical values of b and a. I'm using y hat just to differentiate this y from the y in the data. But these values of a and b are based just on a sample, just 5 data points. I assume that the real value of b and a in the population are beta and alpha. I don't know them. So the real linear relation between y and x is yi equal to beta xi plus alpha plus eta I. Now, what is this eta I again? See, every real system has noise or error in measurement. Though y depends upon x, x cannot explain the behavior of y completely. There will be always minor variations or effects from some other factors. Those factors may be unknown to us or may be out of our control. All those variations and noises are clubbed together in the error term eta. We do not know the value of eta, but we will make some assumptions about it. We will assume that the eta I, that's all these etas, are independent and identically distributed random numbers that follow the normal distribution with zero mean and variance sigma eta square. We will never know the real value of eta I, but we will be able to make some estimates of its statistics from our data and linear regression. Our regression line is y hat equal to bx plus a. When x is xi, y is yi. But following our regression line, y is yi hat. So we have some error. The error ei is equal to yi minus yi hat. We calculate the error for each data point. All these errors should be random numbers. Let's assume that these errors are independent and identically distributed with mean equal to 0. You can also assume that these errors are from a normal distribution with mean 0 and the standard deviation sigma e. Now estimate the variance of the error e from our data. That should be equal to summation of ei minus ei bar, the mean of ei, the square of this whole thing, divided by n minus 2, where n is the number of data points. Note that we have n minus 2 in the denominator, not n, not n minus 1. That is because the degrees of freedom for linear regression with one variable is n minus 2. If we have 2 data points, we can fit a linear line without any error. Then the question of variance of error does not arise. The error comes only when we have more than 2 data points. So the degrees of freedom for fitting a straight line is n minus 2. The mean of the error is 0, so we can remove it and get the variance is equal to summation of ei square divided by n minus 2. The standard deviation of the error is just the square root of this variance. That is also known as the standard error of regression. So far so good. Note that this standard deviation that we calculated from ei is actually an estimate for the standard deviation of eta, the error in our real model. Now I will go back to our original question. Is this regression line a good estimate of the real linear relation between x and y in the population? To answer this question, we will first perform a hypothesis test and then calculate the confidence interval for the coefficients in our regression line. I will use t-test for hypothesis testing. I assume you know the basic concepts of hypothesis testing and particularly the t-test. Before we proceed, let me formalize few things. We are assuming that the real linear relation between x and y is yi equal to beta xi plus alpha plus eta I. Assume eta I follow normal distribution with zero mean and variance sigma eta square. So we have a population and a sample with population regression coefficients and sample regression coefficients. I'll skip the derivation, but it can be proved that the mean of A is equal to alpha and the expectation or mean of B is equal to beta. That means if I do repeated sampling and repeat the regression, the mean of all B's from all these regression will give me the beta, the real value in the population. Similarly, it can be shown that the variance of A is equal to sigma eta square into summation of xi square divided by n into summation of the square of xi minus x bar. You will get the proof for this relation in any standard book on statistics and regression. For example, you can look into the book by John Fox on applied regression analysis. That's what I like, but you can go for any standard textbook you have. Anyway, you don't need to go for derivation to understand what we will discuss here. Now, the variance of A is done, so the variance of B is given by sigma eta square divided by the summation of xi minus x bar square. Accordingly, we can write the standard deviations of A and B from these variances. But we have some other issue here. We do not know the value of sigma eta. But do not worry, we have a solution. Few minutes back, we have derived SE, the standard error of regression, and we have said that is the estimate of sigma eta. So I will replace sigma eta by SE and we get the estimated variances of A and B. As these are estimated variances, I represent those by V hat. Now I will perform the t-test. First, for the slope. Our null hypothesis is beta is equal to 0. And our alternate hypothesis is beta is not equal to 0. See, if not 0, beta could be either positive or negative. So my alternate hypothesis covers both these sides. That means we are doing two-sided or two-tailed t-test. To do the t-test, I need to calculate the t-value. The general form for t-statistics or t-value is t equal to sample statistics minus population parameter divided by estimated standard error of the statistics. For the t-value of beta, sample statistics is the b estimated by regression. Population parameter is beta 0, that is the beta for the null hypothesis. And in the denominator, we will have the estimated standard error of b. Remember that we have already derived the square of it, thus estimated variance of B, and we'll use that. So we get T naught is equal to B minus beta naught divided by SB. As per null hypothesis, beta is 0, so T naught is equal to B divided by SB. To accept or reject a null hypothesis, we have to compare this t value with the critical t value for a given degree of freedom and level of significance. If the calculated t value is bigger than the critical t value, we reject the null hypothesis. I will do the numerical calculation. I have the data and the equation of the regression line. Use this equation and calculate the value of y hat for each value of x. Now get the error for each data point. Using the values of EI, we calculate the standard error of regression, or rather the square of it, SE square. That is equal to 11.733. We use this value to calculate the estimated variance of B. Note, in the denominator, we have sum of the square deviation of x from the mean x. For our problem, the mean of x is 6. I did the calculation and the estimated variance of B is 0.29333. Now, don't get lost in this calculation. We are almost at the end. Now, I have to calculate the t value. We know V, we know B. So the t value for our null hypothesis is 4.062. Now I have to compare this t value with the critical t value. Usually we perform the t test on a computer and the program will do the job for you. But here let's check a t table manually. We have 5 data points. So the degree of freedom for this regression is 5 minus 2, 3. So we follow the row for degree of freedom 3. The t statistics of our null hypothesis is 4.062. It is bigger than 3.182 but smaller than 4.541. The p value for t equal to 3.182 is 0.05. Note that we are doing two-sided test, not the one-sided one. The t statistics of the null hypothesis is bigger than the critical t value for p equal to 0.05. So I reject the null hypothesis. So the real beta is not zero. That means x significantly affects y. I have shown the result for t test in a tabular format. I did the same t test for alpha and here is the data. The t value is 0.278. I check the t table. For 3 degrees of freedom, critical t value for p equal to 0.1 is 1.638. The t value for alpha is smaller than that. That means we cannot reject the null hypothesis. Remember that just like beta, the null hypothesis for alpha is alpha equal to 0. So if we cannot reject the null hypothesis, that means alpha is equal to 0. So even at p equal to 0.1, alpha is not significant. So that means we have to remove alpha from the linear relation between x and y. Now that will affect our regression analysis. Now we cannot fit y equal to bx plus a. We should now fit y equal to bx to the data. I have done the regression and here is the result. With this new regression, the slope is 2.3364 and the R squared is 0.9708. So the R squared has improved. And the t-test also gave better result. Now I will discuss the confidence interval for the regression coefficient. In our revised regression, we have only one coefficient, the slope. But the procedure that I will discuss here would be same for the intercept also whenever it is required. But the first question is, why do I need to calculate the confidence interval for B, the slope? Remember that we believe that the real coefficient is beta, not B. That is the population level coefficient. But we do not know the value of beta. The B is only an estimate of that from the sample. So we need to know the upper and lower limit for beta around the value of the estimated B. And we want to know that at a particular confidence level. For example, we will do the calculation for 95% confidence interval. That will give us 95% assurance that the real beta will lie in the calculated interval around B. Here is the formula for calculating the confidence interval. Beta is equal to B plus minus T of A by 2 times SB. We have already calculated B and SB, but what is this A here? A is related to the confidence level. Confidence level is equal to 100 into 1 minus A in percentage. So for 95% confidence, A is equal to 0.05. Let's do the calculation. B is equal to 2.3364, SB equal to 0.2026. Now get the T value from the T table. We have to take the one-sided value now, and it is 3.182. So we get beta is equal to 2.3364 plus minus 0.6447. In other words, that means 95% confidence interval for beta is from 1.6917 to 2.9811. So we are done with the statistics of our regression line. We have calculated the confidence interval, we have done the t-test, but it's a long video. Here is what we have learned. Our work does not stop simply by doing a linear regression. Once done, check the quality of fit by estimating the R-squared. Also perform the t-test for both the coefficient, the slope and the intercept. The t-test may show that one coefficient like the intercept is not significant. Remove that coefficient from the regression equation and perform the regression again. And you have to do all the analysis again. And also you calculate the confidence interval for the coefficients. Now you can report your regression with all the statistics with confidence. That's all for this video. Thank you for learning with me.